Inshallah, today we'll be focusing on the Quranic narrative, the grand narrative. As you know, every religion, it's built upon a certain foundational stories. And these stories are, you know, traditionally they would call them myths. The word myth has now different meaning. When you say the word myth, it means commonly held false belief. But in the circles of religious studies, the word myth is used to describe a story that entails, you know, the questions that we have as a human being. And these are, you know, burning questions about human origin, about where we are headed, what our destination will be, what is truth, who we are, what our purpose is. So all of these questions usually are answered in these kind of grand narrative stories. And every tradition has their own version of this. In the Quranic text, of course, you might be familiar with some of the characters. You know, Adam and Eve, as mentioned in the biblical scriptures also. So when you dive into that story also, you find that, you know, similar unfolding of events within the human drama from the beginning of time. And so today I want to focus on the story of the Adam and Eve, the creation story, and how does Islam look at the human existence and why we're here and in terms of this origin of human creation. That being said, you know, this story, it has various different, you know, tellings from different scriptures. So, you know, if you're familiar with the story from other scriptures, I just want you to put aside what you know for a second and just listen to it with fresh ears and try to see what the Quranic presentation of that story will be. That being said, the story begins with an announcement in God's court. In the Quran, surah number 2, surah Baqarah, God announces, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. So imagine for a second, there is this immense court filled with divine, you know, angels serving God and praising Him. And suddenly an announcement is made. And God says to them, I'm going to create on earth a representative, a vicegerent. And the word Khalifa here, it has a very honorific meaning. The Khalifa is someone who is a representative of the divine on the face of the earth. And the Khalifa is someone who carries the will of the divine and acts out his rulings. So somebody who's going to be an ambassador, a representative of the king of all existence. And so this is a high spiritual office. And in that court, there is a few different creations that are present. You know, the number one mentioned is وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَ. The first category of beings there is known as Malaika. In the Quran, Malaika is referred to angels, creations that are made of light. And the description of them, according to the Quranic text, it goes as, this creation is a noble creation, kiram and katibin. Some of them are, you know, set as guardians over us. Some of them record our deeds. Some of them carry out various different commands of God. And they don't have free will per se. They do whatever they're commanded. يَفْعَلُونَ مَا تَعْمَلُونَ. They do whatever they're commanded. And this is their description. So having no free will, this creation is a creation of highest you know, dignity and honor, because having no free will means they don't have the will to disobey. And so they're always in a state of obedience of God. And so these angels, when they hear this incredible announcement that there will be a new creation, and this creation will have this high spiritual office, and they will be placed on earth, you know, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَائِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. I'm going to place a vicegerent in the earth. So it's been said and decreed that this creation will be on the earth. The angels, they ask a question. They say, قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ. They say, our Lord, are you going to create a creation that is going to cause corruption and shed blood? And so right off the bat, they have some ideas about what this creation is going to do. And so they're asking the divine, this creation that you're going to put on the earth, they're going to shed blood and cause corruption. And then they add something and they say, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. And we are here glorifying you and exalting you and praising your names. So just to recap, God makes an announcement that I'm going to create this creation who will have this high spiritual office and they will be placed on earth. And right off the bat, the angels, their reaction is, this creation is gonna be trouble. You know, they're gonna cause a lot of corruption and shed blood. And they want to know what is the purpose of this creation, because if it is to worship God, the angels are saying, we are here worshiping you. We're here glorifying you and exalting your names. So why create human beings? The ones that are going to do evil, the ones that are going to do corrupting the world and causing, you know, bloodshed and going to wars. So somehow or other, they have the knowledge of the future of humanity. And Muslim scholars have, they have dwelled on this for a long time, and they have reflected on this. And some of them, they said, how did the angels know that humanity was going to cause all these atrocities? And the interpreters of the Quran, the people that dwell in trying to understand the text and give their exegesis, that some of them said, you know, it could be that God gave them prior knowledge of this. So we're only being led into the story when the announcement is made. But maybe something happened before or after that was not mentioned to us. And you will see this happen a lot in the Quran, where some of the things that we think are important in terms of details, God does not think it's important. So the God will give us the story in a way, some of the details are left out. And you will see later in the story also that, you know, you might be familiar with the story from other scriptures. There are very various details that are not in the Quranic text. So how did the angels know that humanity are going to shed blood and cause corruption? So some of the scholars have said they were given prior knowledge of this from God himself. Others, they were of the opinion that no, there was another creation before human beings that lived on the earth and who were given the spiritual office, and they actually turned evil and corrupt, and they abused the free will and ended up, you know, incurring God's wrath upon them. And so, you know, there's a lot of, you know, research done in that field. And some of the people that want to go with that opinion, they actually go into studying different studies in terms of, you know, archaeology and things to see what is the lifespan of humanity, and has there been intelligent creation on earth before human beings. And there's some interesting books you can look into. Forbidden archaeology, one of them, they find fossil things that are billions of years old that doesn't fit the conventional story of human beings coming from Africa and evolving and other things. So anyway, there's these two different views of this. And so our scholars then, they continue, they said, well, the angels, we know their nature. Their nature is they don't question God. We know their nature is never to disobey God. Their nature is to always be in a state of obedience because they have no free will. But here, clearly, they're asking a question. Are you going to create a creation that's going to cause corruption and shed blood? So, you know, this is one of the problems in theology and every tradition, they face this question of problem of evil. You know, if God is merciful and God is loving, why is there evil in the world? And according to the Islamic theologians, the evil does not exist in the world per se, but the evil exists within the hearts and minds of human beings. And that is part of the package deal that comes with having free will. Having free will means the will to disobey. Having free will means the will to deny God, the will to turn away from God. And so the human being is given this capacity. And this is part of them being a representative of God, because being a representative, God has dressed them up with his attributes. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. So after the angels, they ask this question, they say, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. We are here glorifying you and exalting your names and declaring your holiness. And you could see that there's something else they're not saying. Something they're not saying. Although, you know, on the surface, they're saying, why create human beings? We're worshiping you. But there's a subtext that's not being mentioned. And this is out of the politeness of the angels. And, you know, they have incredible etiquette when they're talking to the divine. And so God says, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun. Oh, my angels, I know that which you don't know. I know something you don't know. And so God is basically telling them, you have to have trust in the divine wisdom. Whatever I'm creating, I have some knowledge about them that you don't know. And the Quranic conception of God is all-knowing, and he knows everything. Not a leaf falls without his knowledge. He can see the ant crawling on a black rock in the darkness of the night. So there is something that is hidden, something that is open, doesn't matter what it is. God has full knowledge of it. And angels being a limited creation of God, They're not able to see that wisdom. So God tells them, I know something you don't know. Just wait and see. And then the Quran says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ أَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. So the creation of Adam has taken place. And the Quran mentions that the human being was created and molded by the hands of the divine. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ آدَمْ عَلَى سُورَتِهِ. That Allah, he created Adam upon his image. And our scholars, they have a difference of opinion what that really means. The first group said the word his here refers to Adam. So Adam was created in the image in which he's created. In other words, he's given this image and he doesn't go through different phases of life. And this is one opinion, and this is a weaker opinion. The other is they said Adam is created upon God's image. And it is not an image that you and I can conceive. It's not talking about the form, but rather Adam is given attributes that are telling of God's attributes. And so you're able to see. And this is from God's name, the one who sees, Al-Basir. You're able to hear. And this is from God's name, As-Sami', the one who hears. You're given knowledge. And this is from God's name, Al-Alim, the one who knows. And you're given wisdom. This is from God's name, Al-Hakim, the one who has wisdom. And so they said, human being then is dressed up and adorned with the attributes of the divine. And that is fitting for this creation because they will be representing the divine on the face of the earth. And so this creation is now created. And the first thing that happens is وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ أَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. The human being is bestowed and taught all of the names. Now, in the other scriptures, Adam, he comes to know the names. You know, he comes to name things because God commands him to name things. In the Quranic scripture, the story is, God teaches Adam the names. And this is, of course, up for question also. Names, what names? Is it names of all the creation? Is it names of all the things that exist, all the events that will happen? Or is it names of God? And God has infinite names, according to the Quranic, prophetic tradition. And 99 of them have been made to, you know, revealed upon mankind. And so, you know, if the majority of the scholars, as they go with this, some of them, they say Adam, then he was given knowledge of all the names, and therefore he knew all the knowledge of God from the beginning. Others, they say he was given the names of God. And whenever you know names, our scholar said language and the way we communicate, it's all built upon names. Everything we do, everything we speak of, names represent symbols. And symbols allows us to internalize the world outside and create an internal map of the reality that's out there. So the symbols, the names, it allows us to have internal representation of the reality outside. And that is necessary for people to understand the reality of God, because you cannot know God with your senses. You can only know God with your inner vision. And for that, you have to have the nourishment of the inner self, which is knowledge and names and understanding of these symbols. And so Adam is given all these names. And one of the fascinating things, there's a scholar by the name of Sam'ani. He mentions that every time you learn the name of something, the name has different layers of knowledge. The first is, of course, the most obvious one. Every sound, every name that you learn is either an image or a sound or some kind of symbol that has an outward appearance. So when it comes to language, names have a sound, a distinct sound. And so if I want to talk about a tree, all I have to tell you is the word tree. And I shape my tongue and I breathe out and the sound emerges. And somehow or rather, you understand that I'm talking about this thing that grows from the ground and it has leaves and it's green. So symbols have, you know, their outward appearance, but also they have an inward concept. And so when you learn the names of God, for example, in Arabic, there is 99 names. Our prophet told us, whoever learns them is immune from the torment on the day of judgment. He said, you know, the names of God, you know, whoever learns them, whoever memorizes them, and to count them is to know them, they're immune from the wrath of God. So when you look at those names, each one of them has an outward sound, right? So you say Ar-Rahman. Rahman means the most merciful. So the sound is Rahman, but then there's an internal concept of what does that mean, right? So there's a meaning that goes with it. And the meaning can be grasped by the use of the intellect, by reflection and meditation. It can be expanded upon. It can be, have a deeper sense of understanding that name. But also, that name has a certain reality. It has a taste. And Adam, being taught those names, he started to yearn to taste those, the reality of those names. And our scholars have said, all the creation is actually endowed and given certain names of the divine. For example, when you look at a flower is alive. And its life comes from the name of God, Al-Hayy, the one who gives life. And it has beauty. It comes from the name of God, Al-Jamil, the one who gives beauty. But aside from that, it doesn't have a lot of the divine names because it's a lower form of creation. And you look at mountains, they have a certain type of awe-inspiring characteristic, right? There's magnificent, mighty things that tower over us. So they have a portion of the name Al-Aziz, the one who's mighty, Al-Jabbar, the one who's overpowering or dominating. But you know, when it comes to other names, mountains cannot carry those names. And the Quran mentions, if we were to reveal this revelation upon the mountains would have collapsed into dust. And so having the knowledge of the divine completely, if it was revealed to any creation, this creation would not be able to bear this knowledge. It would collapse into dust. But then God says, but we revealed it upon the heart of you, O Prophet Muhammad. So in other words, the human heart has been designed and made to hold all these realities, all these different, you know, names of divine, and be able to contemplate and taste its reality. And so Adam, having been taught all these names, he's now yearning to experience and taste these names because he is a creation who's created to know God. He's a representative of God. And, you know, he's the representative of all of creation to God. Yet at the same time, he's God's representative to the creation. So this role that human being has is a two-way street. And it's most beautifully filled by the prophets. The Quran recognizes certain human beings that have been chosen by God to be representatives of God to mankind, but also to be representatives of mankind in the divine presence. So Adam, being given that spiritual office, and now he's been given these names, he's come to realize the name of God, Al-Alim, the one who has knowledge. And then God brings Adam in the presence of all these angels. And remember, they were asking questions that you're going to create a creation that's going to shed blood and cause corruption. And we're here glorifying you and exalting your names. And we mentioned there's something they're not saying here. And the scholars, they said, what the angels were getting at is that this mighty spiritual office, the angels were basically presenting their resume, saying, dear God, this creation is not fit for this position. But we are the ones doing all these great things, exalting your names and glorifying you. So they had some claim to greatness. But the humility of the angels prevented them from saying, we should be the representatives. You know, they were not able to say that. But that thought did cross their hearts. That thought did cross their minds. So God brings all the angels and he speaks to them and he says, oh, my angels, give me the names of all the things. You know, give me the names of everything if you are truthful. And if you are truthful is alluding to what they had hidden inside themselves. Because in the Quran, you know, if you say, if you're truthful, then prove yourself. What you're really saying is you made a claim, so you have to prove your claim. And even though the angels, they didn't make any outward claims, they're now being put on the spot. Name everything if you are indeed amongst those who are truthful. And the angels, they recognize that they don't have the knowledge that God is asking them to present. So they say, قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. They say, glory be to you. How exalted are you? We have no knowledge except whatever you have taught us. So they recognize that whatever knowledge they have is from the knowledge of God. And the limitations they have is also from God. And they cannot transgress or they cannot go beyond their limits. Whatever God has allowed them to see, whatever God has allowed them to know, that is all they can know and they cannot know beyond that. And so they recognize that and they submit themselves. They say, glory be to you. We have no knowledge except what you taught us, and you are the most knowledgeable, the most wise. And then God says to them, O Adam, tell them the names. So, you know, yeah, وَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمُ أَنْبِئْهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِمْ. And the word أَنْبِئْ, you know, it comes from the word نَبَأ. And نَبَأ means to present the great news. And this is the word used for a prophet. In Islam, the prophet is known as a Nabi. A Nabi is somebody who brings the great news from God. And so remember, he said, I know something you don't know. Human being is now being given this news of the things that angels don't even know. And human being is told, tell the angels the names of all things. And so Adam starts naming whatever God had taught him. And, you know, of course, the debate stands whether it's the names of the creation or the names of God. But Adam informs the angels of the names, and he's now feeling the honor and the dignity that God has bestowed upon them. And he's beginning to taste some of the names that he was given, the names related to God's honor, God's dignity. And what's interesting about the creation of Adam, all the angels being a spiritual being, they still were creation of God, and they were created, God says in the Quran, they were created from the command of God. You know, God said to them, be, and they became. Whereas the human being, the Quran mentions the human being, the physical form of the human being was created by God, yet there is something inside him that was deposited into his being that is the breath of the divine and the spirit of the divine. And so there is a divine reality that is living within the human being. And it is the essence that is bringing the human being to life. And that is what allows the human being to be the representative. So God says to the angels, bow down to Adam. And all the angels, they bow down. And the saints and the people of Allah, they said that this act of the angels bowing down to Adam, you know, this is something that is in the primordial existence before the creation of the physical forms. And those angels, they're bowing to Adam is symbolic of them being supportive of Adam in his mission. And here, Adam represents all of humanity. For example, in different languages and in the Islamic cultures, the word Adam literally is used to mean human being. In Urdu, they say Admi, Admi. You know, Admi means a person of who's an Adam, Adamic person. In Farsi, Adam. Uzbeki also, they say Adam. Turkish, Adam. So the word Adam is symbolically used to mean mankind. And so these angels, they, in their obedience to the divine, they bow down, you know, making Adam the focal point of their worship of God. And so the reality of God is ever present. But now God has made Adam the focal point by which all of these angels are you know, bowing down and prostrating themselves to God. And so when all these angels are bowing down, as far as the eyes can see, you know, and you may wonder how many angels were there, you know, and the Prophet Muhammad, he told us, you know, above the Kaaba, and Kaaba is a place that is the focal point for human beings. You know, when we want to worship God, the Quran says, فَأَيْنَمَا تَوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. Wherever you turn your face, God's face is in front of you. So in other words, God is ever present, is omnipotent, and he's ever present. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ, he says in the Quran. And he is with you wherever you are. And so, you know, having an ever-present, you know, you have to wonder, how do I worship him? Where do I turn? And so God has made the Kaaba symbolic of the oneness of God. So all the Muslims, we have a direction we turn to worship God. Similarly, God had made Adam the focal point for the angels. But Prophet Muhammad, he said, above the Kaaba, in the higher realms of spiritual existence, there are places like it to which the angels, they come and they worship God and they do their pilgrimage and they go around it in circumambulating it. And every single day, 70,000 angels, they come visit these places. And each heaven has its own, focal point. And there are many multiple layers to the spiritual realms. And he says, every single day, 70,000 angels, they come and then they perform their rites and rituals and they leave and they never come back. And this has been happening from the beginning of time until the end of time. So if you want to do some math, billions of years the world has existed. You know, it's a long time. So that means there's a lot of angels and they're all bowing down. As far as the eyes could see, Adam is now witnessing the majesty of God, the power of God, the honor and the dignity of God as he's witnessing all these angels bow to him. Yet he still doesn't know God with full knowledge because there's names related to God's wrath, God's anger, God's distance. Everything he's witnessing so far is related to honor and dignity and knowledge and wisdom, but he doesn't yet know and realize the other names. And all the other creations are cut off from having full knowledge of God because of their limited creation, their limited aspect. But the human being is the only creation that has the capacity to know God with full knowledge. The beasts, they cannot know God because they only know distance. The angels, they cannot know God fully because they only know closeness. But the human being can experience closeness and distance. They can experience pleasure and pain. They can experience ease and hardship. They can experience his mercy and his wrath. And so Adam, having knowledge of all these names, he's yearning to know. He wants to know God, because you cannot love God fully unless you know God fully. And so on top of all this honor and dignity and all prestige and everything, God then tells Adam, go and enter paradise. Now, before that happens, there's a small drama that takes place. There's one being amongst the angels. He refuses to bow. As God commands all of them to bow down to Adam, one creation stands firm and he says, I'm not bowing to him. And the Quran says, فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ. When God told the angels to bow, they all bowed except for a creature named Iblis. فَفَسَقَ عَنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّهِ. And he denied the command of his Lord. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And he was of those who were ungrateful. And so what's interesting here is the Quran kind of forces us to take a holistic look at it. Because if you take this verse by itself, God commanded the angels to bow. They all bowed except for Iblis, which would make us conclude that Iblis is one of the angels, because the command was given to angels and all of them bowed down except. So if I say all the students came to school except for John, that means John is one of the students, right? So the language has a tendency to make you think that Iblis is one of the angels. But elsewhere in the Quran, God says, when God told the angels to bow, they all bowed except for Iblis. And then he says, "Kana min al-jinn." He was of the jinn. And this is a different creation. A different creation. It's not amongst the angels, not created from mud like human beings, but a creation that God says was created from smokeless fire, a type of energy. And this creation also has as a degree of free will and knowledge. And so, but they are also limited in their capacity to know God. So when Iblis refuses to bow, he has a certain idea for himself. He uses his reason and rationale, and he tells God, God asks him, why didn't you bow when I told you to bow? He says, Ana khayrun min. I am better than him. This is something the angels, they couldn't dare say, but Iblis says it. He says, Ana khayrun min. I am better than him. In other words, he has a claim to greatness. And his claim to greatness is, خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَار وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن تِين. You created me from fire, and you created him from dirt. And this is another proof in the Quran that Iblis was not from the angels, contrary to the other scriptures and the beliefs of the other religions. They tend to go with the belief that Iblis was an angel, and he was a fallen angel. But in Islam, we don't have the concept of fallen angels. The angels, they're always in a state of obedience. But this was a different creation. You could use the word demons and other things to describe this. So the word Iblis literally means the one who's cut off. The one who's cut off. Cut off from what? From God's mercy, from God's, from God's encompassing love. And so he has something within himself that he was hiding for a long time. And that is his belief that he is greater than other creations. And the scholars, they dwell on how was he included in the command given to the angels to bow down to Adam. And they came to the conclusion, and if you go with the other creation existed before mankind theory, they said that this creation, transgressed their limits, and God sent down armies of angels from the sky to destroy these nations. And Iblis participated in that. And so he was elevated and he was given honor and rank. So he was included in the company of the angels, even though he was not an angel. And the others, they say that, no, Iblis, God is, one of his names is Al-Khalaq. Al-Khalaq means the ones who's constantly creating new creations. And he does not tire of creating new creations. And there are infinite creations that you and I cannot even imagine or fathom. So there's other creations besides the human beings that have existed from before time and before history, and it will continue to exist after history. And Iblis was one of such creations, and he had worshipped God in such a way. And Prophet Muhammad, he said that there was not a single place on earth that was left except that Iblis had prostrated himself in the worship of God. And, he had, very devoted creation. And so he was elevated, but his religious status blinded him from witnessing God, and he ended up witnessing his own self. And he stopped seeing the blessings of God, and he starts seeing himself as great. So he says, "Ana khayrun min, I am better than him. Khalaqtani min nar, you created me from fire, and you created him from dirt." And he commits one of the greatest sins that is possible in the divine presence of God, the sin of arrogance and putting himself in a high position. And God says, "This is not a place for you to be arrogant, O Iblis. Get down from here." And when he's demoted, you could say, and he's cast out from the divine presence, his response to this is not that of apology. He did not seek forgiveness. He did not ask, you know, he did not admit any guilt. Immediately, he started blaming. And this is the nature of arrogance. When somebody has arrogance, they want to always cast blame at others. And Iblis, in the state that he was in, he casts his blame at God. He says, "I swear by your honor, you misguided me because of this creation. I will wait for them in ambush in front of them and behind them and to their right and to their left. And I will make sure majority of them are not grateful." And this is his promise to God. He swears by God that he will wait in ambush. And our scholars, they go into some detail. What does it mean? He will come from front, from behind, from their right, from their left. And they said, you know, the front of the human being represents the thoughts of the future. You know, when you're looking ahead in your life, you'll have, you know, certain thoughts that will give you anxiety, that will give you worries, that will give you fear, or you know, you won't be able to sleep at night thinking, am I going to make the bills? Am I going to meet this project's deadline? Am I going to do this? Am I going to do that? What will happen with my children? So he's promising that he will come at them from front of them and make them lose hope in trust in God's plan. And come at them from behind them. In other words, you know, whatever actions that we did, whatever history that we have, you know, sometimes we let go of certain sins and it will come from behind, and, you know, our past, basically they say the past will catch up to you. And so it'll come up with things that will keep drawing us back into certain patterns of behavior that are destructive. And come at them from their right. You know, somebody's righteous and religious and they're living a good life, and he will come at them and say, "You are great. You know, there's nobody greater than you." And so you start to see that you are the person who's living the highest, most moral life. And you start looking down on others. And this is, you know, even though you're on the right side of the world, but, you know, he can come and turn that against you and come at you from the left, you know, take you away from to a straight path, take you away from the righteous life, from the moral life, and make a person engage in shamelessness and things that are destructive to our nature. And so this is his promise. And then he says, "And I will make sure I will make them cut the ears of the cattle, and I'll make them change your creation." And so he sort of underestimates himself. He says, "I'll make them cut the ears of the cattle," means he's going to urge the human beings to deform the creation of God, "and I'll make them change your creation." And now you see like plastic surgeries and the genetic modifications and all these different things. So he kind of underestimated himself there. But God says to him, "Do whatever you want. You have been given respite." And there's this idea that God rules heaven and Satan rules hellfire. This is foreign to the Islamic idea. In Islam, Satan is a servant of God, but he's been cast out. And when he goes to hellfire, he's going there for punishment. He's not going there to rule over anything. He's gonna, in the Quran, he makes a speech on the Day of Judgment that anyone who followed me, I promised you lies and God had promised you truth. And I have deceived you. And I did not have any power over you, but you decided to follow me. So blame yourselves and don't blame me. This is in Surah Ibrahim in the Quran. So anyway, so God gives Satan this respite. And he asked for this. He said, "Give me respite until the end of time, that I may misguide them and I may come to them with my minions and whisper into their hearts." And God says, "Do whatever you want. You have until the end of time. And my servants that are sincere, that are sincere upon the straight path, you shall have no power over them." So Adam is then brought into paradise. Now you can see now there's the creation of angels. They have a claim to greatness, mainly their actions of worshiping God. There is this creation called jinn. They have a claim to greatness because of who they are and what they're made from. They're basically the original racist people. They say, "I am created this way and he's created that way. I am better than him." And now you have this human creation who hasn't yet experienced anything except honor and dignity and knowledge and all these things. And then God puts him in paradise and he creates for him a mate from himself. And the scholars just said that his mate is not created from his body. In Islam, we have different layers to the human existence. You have the essence of the human existence, which is the soul, the spirit that is blown in by God. And then you have what is called the nafs. The nafs is the meeting place between the spirit and the physical form. And it is what you could describe as the self of the human being, but it's not yet the physical form. And then you have the physical form. And we have a lot of debates about when Adam was in the presence of the divine and when he entered paradise, in which form was he? Was he in the physical form or was he in a different form? And majority of the Muslim scholars, they said he was actually in a spiritual form that God had bestowed upon him. This is before his physical form that appears on the earth. So going back, Adam is now brought into paradise. God says to him, you and your wife eat and enjoy whatever you like, except for this one tree. وَلَا تَقَرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةَ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ Don't come near this tree or you will be amongst the wrongdoers. Now, what's interesting is in the other scriptures, there's details about this tree. Oh, it was an apple tree. It was a tree of knowledge and of good and evil and all these different things. In the Quran, none of that is mentioned. All that is mentioned is God gave them all of paradise to roam and eat from and enjoy, except for one tree. That's it. Don't come near this one. And so they dwell in paradise for only he knows how many years, million years, billion years. And paradise is a pure representation of God's mercy, unadulterated, unaltered, pure mercy. And so Adam is now experiencing the names of God related to his generosity, the names of God related to his mercy, the names of God related to his love, his giving, his compassion. And he's not just understanding those names conceptually, he's living them. He knows them experientially. And this is the thing in the Islamic theologians and the Gnostics. The theologians, their approach to understanding the divine is always their focus on the names of God that cannot be known. So they say, even though we have things that we can say that allows us to know God, but God is beyond all of that. God is not this, not this, not this. This is the approach of the theologians. And majority of them, they end up focusing on exalting God, and they focus on the transcendence of God. And doing so, they focus on God's justice and mercy and his wrath and his power, his kingship. Whereas the Gnostics, they focus on God's closeness, God's mercy, God's love. And they focus on the intimacy with God and having intimate experiential knowledge of God. And they end up affirming, you know, God's presence in your life and day to day. And their entire thing is having experiential knowledge of the imminence of God in your life. So Adam is now knows the reality of God's mercy in his imminence by experiencing paradise to its fullest. But now Satan has been let loose, Iblis, Shaitan, as it is mentioned in the Quran. And Shaitan is somebody that is created from fire. It's filled with rage, filled with anger, and it's filled with envy and jealousy because he wanted that spiritual position to be God's representative. But he wasn't chosen for that job. And now he's declared war on Adam and his children. And the Quran says, فَأَدَلَّهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ Satan came to them and start to deceive them and start to lie to them. And he tells them, shall I take you to a tree that will give you eternal life? Shall I take you to a tree that will, if you eat from it, you will not die, that you will live in paradise and you will become one of the angels that are present always around the throne of God. So he's trying to intrigue them. And Adam, human being, in the Quranic word, the word for human being is insan. And the insan, they said, comes from two possible roots in Arabic. One is nisyan, and nisyan means the one who forgets. And the other is uns. The uns means somebody who's intimate, who's in love. And so human being has these two capacities. They can be engrossed in love with the divine, but also they have the capacity to forget. So Adam, slowly, he's deceived and he's brought closer and closer to the tree. And what's interesting, the Quran does not say that God told Adam, don't eat from the tree. He said, وَلَا تَقَرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ Don't come close to the tree. And so our scholars, they draw from this that this tree had qualities that are akin to temptation, that it will suck you in, it will pull you in. And It's as if somebody was to stand in the middle of the road and they say, you know what, I believe in God and I'm a firm believer. No car is going to hit me, you know. But if you're in the middle of the highway, you put yourself in an environment where it becomes possible for you to get hit by cars. And so, you know, avoiding sin, the secret of avoiding, you know, things that are destructive to us, God is telling us here, don't do it, but avoid being close to it. Don't even go into that environment. So Adam, he's being drawn closer. And the word adallahuma, the same word is used for when you pull a bucket of water out of the well. You slowly, slowly pull on it, right? The same similar word is used to describe that motion. So Adam and his wife, Eve, they're slowly, slowly being pulled towards that. And then God says, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا. And he swore to them by God. He said, I am a sincere advisor to you. All I want is good for you. Eat from this tree. And you will see what I want for you is good. And so being a new creation, they have no experience of lies and deception and kind of like pure children, you know. Parents tell their children, you know, somebody comes knocking at the door, say, tell them I'm not home. And the person, you know, the child comes to the door and says, my dad says he's not home. You know, they're kind of, we're not designed to lie. We are taught to lie. And so what happens, Adam, and this is one of the Quranic motif, our prophet, he told us that every single human being is created and born upon the fitrah in a state of purity. There is no such a thing as original sin, according to the Quranic version. And everybody is born pure in a state of the divine presence, and they are in a state of acceptance from the divine. Nobody's born stigmatized with any kind of sin or any kind of darkness that they have to go through some kind of ritual to purify. And so the Quran affirms that human being is a good creation, a pure creation. That does not mean good in the sense we measure. Like, for example, you know, somebody might make the argument, you know, son, you're obeying me too much. You know, don't obey me so much. No, children have to be taught obedience. But those are things that come into this world in the way that we relate to each other. But as it stands, the nature of the human being is pure and it's always inclining to what is good. Even though when it comes to experiencing the world and them exploring, the adults may judge the children as being naive, as being troublemakers or whatever it is. But the nature of the human being, according to the Quranic view, is something that is good and pure, and it only becomes corrupted as we corrupt them, you know, as we raise them up and indoctrinate them in with different things. So anyway, so Adam is now lied to, and Iblis, he swears by God, and they end up eating from the tree. And when they eat from the tree, a caller calls out in paradise, Adam, he has disobeyed. Adam has disobeyed. And Adam and Eve, God says, they became aware that their nakedness became aware to them. And immediately their human response is they have a sense of shame. And this is a very, very important thing that is embedded in the human consciousness, that human beings have the capacity to feel ashamed, right? Somebody who can feel shame is not likely to do things that brings shame upon them. And so when Adam eats from the tree, the scholars have said the nakedness that he feels there is not nakedness of the body, but it's they feel that they have done something wrong and they're exposed in the presence of God as the wrongdoers. And this is a very overwhelming feeling for somebody who's confronted with something that is shameful. And so Adam and Eve, they end up trying to cover themselves. And God says to them, why did you disobey? A point to note here also, in the Quran, God says, you know, فَأَذَلَّهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ. You know, Satan deceived both of them. So God, he places the blame on Satan. And, you know, in the other traditions, you might see that, you know, the serpent is there, and then the serpent deceives the woman, and then the woman deceives the man. In the Quranic narration, no, both of them ate from the tree. But the blame goes on Satan because Satan deceived them. So now the question comes to Adam. Oh, Adam, why did you eat from the tree when I told you not to eat from it? And here Adam says something profound. He says, Rabbana zalamna anfusana. Our Lord, we have wronged ourselves. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And if you don't have mercy on us and you don't forgive us, then we are amongst the losers. We are doomed. We're done. And our scholars said, here you can see that Adam, He ate from the tree. Some of the scholars, they said Adam actually wanted to know what happens if he wants to experience the other names and the divine attributes of God. So he actually traded all of paradise for the knowledge of God by eating from this tree so that he could experience the divine distance and other things. So when he's asked, why did you eat from it? He said, we wronged ourselves. Even though he has every right to blame Satan. And God himself blames Satan, that Satan deceived them and Satan pulled them and whispered to them and lied to them and blamed, you know. But Adam, he doesn't blame Satan. His wife doesn't blame Satan. They blame themselves. They say, Rabbana ظلمنا أنفسنا. And so our scholars said, there is something interesting here. The creation of angels, they had a claim to greatness. And they said, نَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. We are glorifying you and exalting your names and declaring your holiness. The jinn kind had their claim to greatness. We're better than him. You created us from fire. You created him from dirt. Why should we bow down to dirt? Adam made no claim to greatness. He said, we wronged ourselves. If you don't have mercy and forgive us, we are doomed. And so each one cling to something. The angels cling to their deeds. The jinn, they cling to something that they were created from. The human being, they start holding on to the divine mercy and divine forgiveness. And so God says, so God forgave Adam. And God honored Adam. And God brought him into this world as a king, as a representative, to bring out the command of God and to establish and build upon the earth and to make manifest the will of God upon the earth. And so according to the Quranic narration, then the human being come into this world is not a punishment, but rather it is a necessary phase of the human growth into understanding God's knowledge, into understanding God's reality and experiencing his names with full knowledge. And so when the angels asked, are you going to create a creation that's going to shed blood and cause corruption? God said, I know what you don't know. God knew that this creation, being flawed, being a creation that has weaknesses, they are going to have a lot of, you know, shortcomings, and therefore they're going to depend on God's mercy and God's forgiveness, and God is going to forgive them, and God's going to show them mercy. So in other words, I know what you don't know. They will do all these things, but I might forgive them, right? And so what is greater than God's mercy? What is greater than God's compassion and God's forgiveness? And so the Quranic picture, the Quranic grand narrative of human existence and life and death and all of it, that we're here in this world. And God says to Adam when he comes down, you know, go down from here, you and your wife, you will have a short time upon the earth, and I'll continue to send you my signs. And whoever follows my signs, they shall have no fear upon them, nor shall they grieve. In other words, you know, this is a place in which God's signs, God's revelation will manifest. And whoever recognizes them and aligns themselves with God, then they will have no fear and no grief. And we talked about the concept of fear and grief being related to the past and the future. And the human reality is something that is infinitely deep that can be explored. And the meeting place with God is actually within the human creation itself, because the divine breath resides within you. And our prophet, peace be upon him, he said, God, he turned to the heavens and asked them, and the heavens said, we cannot contain you. He turned to the earth, and the earth said, we cannot contain you. But he said, the human being, they're able to, you know, they took on this trust. They took on this trust. And so neither the heavens nor the earth can contain the presence of God, but the heart of a believing servant contains the presence of God. And so this creation is an honored creation. And so the question of then comes down to, what about, you know, if God is so merciful and all these things, how come all these bad deeds and sins and all these things exist? Our prophet, peace be upon him, he said, human beings, they sin by day and by night. As long as they seek God's forgiveness, God will match them with equal forgiveness. And he said, if your sins were to reach the clouds in the sky and you turn to God and seek his forgiveness, he will match it with equal forgiveness and forgive you and honor you and turn all those bad deeds into good deeds. And so when the question was posed to the great saints and the people that really understood the message of the Quran, because the Quran has layers and layers of meaning, and to each person, according to their spiritual state, according to the condition of their hearts, the Quran addresses them differently. And sometimes some of its secrets become known to people, some of it is veiled, even though you can be reading the same portion of the chapter of the Quran, you may not be able to penetrate into the meanings of some aspects of the Quran, whereas somebody else whose heart is ready to receive that, they're able to see. So they asked the great saints, they said, look, so God's mercy, you know, how can we understand it as a human being? The saints and the great people of knowledge, they said, you know, in the Quran mentions, you know, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلِ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. If you don't understand something, you don't know something, then ask those who know. Right? So the Quran kind of encourages us to know. So they said, God's mercy is infinite. And what does it mean, infinite? It means it has no limits. It has no ends. So let's say you come on the day of judgment and you are a believer in God. And God promised you paradise, and God promised you great things, and God promised you all these forgiveness and everything. And on the day of judgment, you find God merciful and forgiving, right? It's not a big deal because you're expecting all of that. You're living an upright life. You did everything possible. And so God forgave you, and God sanctified you and gave you a high place in paradise. Somebody else, God presented them this world, and God, you know, brought them the signs. They rejected the signs. God threatened them. God said, I'm going to punish you. I'm going to throw you in hellfire. And none of them had any effect on him. And he lived a life of promiscuity and evil deeds and everything. On the day of judgment, it is possible. It is possible that God only manifested their life in the way that he did so that he can manifest on the day of judgment the greatest extent of his mercy. He forgives you. You're a believer. Big deal. But somebody who has no sense of, you know, they had no hope. They're going to be destroyed on the day of judgment. If God forgives him, isn't that a greater show of mercy? Isn't that a greater show of forgiveness? And so they said, but that is not to be confused between salvation and sanctification, right? Being saved does not mean being honored. Being forgiven does not mean being granted, great dignity and a great honor in the sight of God. So anyway, So that's something that we have to think about and dwell on. And our scholars, they say that one of the greatest sins a human being can commit is to actually lose hope in the mercy of God. Because all of this creation is only telling that God is more merciful than he is wrathful. And in the Quran, he mentions that he has written over his throne, my mercy overcomes my wrath. And he says in the Quran, كَتَبَ رَبُّكَ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ رَحْمَةً. Your Lord has written for himself, prescribed for himself mercy. And another verse he says, رَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. My mercy encompasses all things. And so that being said, this is the story of creation according to the Quranic narration. There is one subject that we didn't touch on, which is the subject of evolution. And how does that fit in with the Quranic view? Our scholars, they differentiate between the word insan in the word bashar. The word insan means the human being that is conscious, that is conscientious, that has the spirit, that has the knowledge, the awareness. And the word bashar means the human form. The human form, according to the Islamic scholars, is an animal form. And it has animalistic desires, such as copulation and anger and all these different things. And therefore, the human being, according to some of the Muslim scholars, their form may have existed on the earth and evolved over time. And there was a scholar by the name of Ibn Muskawai. He lived before Darwin, and he presented this theory according to the knowledge of archaeology and things in his time. He said that, you know, God created minerals and things happened in a chain of events. He said then that led to things evolving, and the highest of minerals, he said, is the coral. And this is, of course, a person who lived 1,000 years ago. I just want you to know how he was thinking about the creation. He said, and then God created the plant life, and the plant life evolved. He said, and the highest form of it was a palm tree, because whatever you cut off, it survives. But if you cut off its head, it dies, and it resembles most the animal creation. And then he said, God created animals, and the highest of them were monkeys. And this is a Muslim scholar before Darwin. He said, and then what happened from that? God created the form of the human being, and that evolved into the human form. And then the spirit of Adam descended into one of them that God had chosen. And so according to the Quranic narration, the Quran actually challenges us to go and find out how life started. It says, قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ بَدَعَ الْخَلْقِ. Tell them to travel through the land and observe. فَانْظُرْ means to see, make observations. how we started the creation. So how the creation started, according to the Quranic narration, it is possible for us to discover, it is possible for us to know, and the search for that in whatever field that we inquire, whether it's archaeology or biology or astronomy or genetics, whatever it is actually considered an act of worship in the Islamic perspective, and it is worthy of reward from God. And so that being said, there is a lot of Muslims that don't understand that aspect of the flexibility of the Quran, because the Quran mentions that the human body is created from water and earth. And everything that is within our body is actually made from elements that are found in the earth. And so you know, everything that the Quran mentions, it's not in the detail way which we find in other scriptures that, you know, it was like a pottery in which God blew into him and pottery was hollow. Even though some of those narrations made their way into Islamic narratives, but we consider those secondary evidences and not the primary. The primary evidence, of course, is the Quran and the authentic hadith of Prophet Muhammad. And all of that is in line with the discoveries that are being made. Although there's a lot of gaps in the theory of evolution as it is today, but the concepts of things changing over time and adapting and all of that, it is acceptable according to the Quranic view of the world. And that is the end of my presentation. We have, I believe, 4 minutes for questions and answers. I'm sorry, it went kind of long. Any questions?
I think you've given us so much to think about, and well, there's a message. Let's see what it says. It just says, excellent presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, I would
reiterate that sentiment. So much wonderful information. And I think people can unmute themselves. If they have a question, please feel free to ask your question.
There is one question that said, is all of the story intended to be accepted literally, or some of it to be understood metaphorically? So the thing about these stories, as I said, these are the great narratives, right? They do lend themselves to a lot of interpretation because of the symbolism contained within them. When it comes to these stories, even when you understand them literally, because of the elements involved in them, our literal understanding may not be the actual events. So, for example, how do you understand God spoke to the angels? Does God speak in the way we speak? Does God, so there's things that even if you were to go at it and try to understand it in a literal way, it is beyond the human conception. And so these are things that have to be experienced. And that's where I side with the Muslim Gnostics that said that knowledge of God, even though you can study about the Islamic theology and understand all of these things, all of that leads you to more knowledge about God. So that knowledge leads, the end of that knowledge is actually more knowledge. And that doesn't make you arrive at the presence of God, like the experience of feeling the presence of God, you know, within yourself and feeling that presence in your own experience of life. And so those stories, then they lend themselves into different realms of experience within yourself. And those are all symbolic. So they could be understood metaphorically, but there's also a spiritual experience and tasting of those if you meditate on them. So metaphorically means you can understand it in a symbolic way in your mind, but we're talking about something deeper than that. And so we ask God to give us that openings, spiritual openings.
There's a question about how was Eve created?
So the Quran mentions that Eve was created from Adam. And there's, of course, some of the Muslim scholars who tend to approach the Quran from a literal perspective, and there's a certain schools of thought that do that. We have the Ahmad ibn Hanbal school, we have the Zahiris, they tend to more have a literal analytics. They tend to say that Adam was created from the rib of Eve was created from the rib of Adam, and they understand it from the body of Adam. Whereas the other scholars, they argue, they said it's not talking about the form of Adam, but the Quran says, "Inna khalaqnakum min nafsin wahida." We created you from one nafs. And we mentioned about nafs, it's the meeting place between the terrestrial and the celestial, the meeting place between the spiritual and the earthly aspect of human beings. And this is something that is experienced as the self of the human being. So that one self, it was then brought into reality as two. Even though it's one, its manifestation became two. وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا, God says, and we created from that nafs its mate. And in the Quran, he says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَجًا. And one of his signs is that he created for you mates from yourself. And the self is different than your body, the jasad. You know, the word for body in the Quran is jasad or jism, which does not appear anywhere in the creation of Eve. So I tend to agree with the scholars that say that Eve's creation is a spiritually part of Adam. And that actually extends down the line with everybody that finds their soulmate, right? You live with somebody that you love, you know, that love, it emerges from something deeper than your just emotions or chemicals in your brain. It's something deeper than that. And that's recognizing yourself in the other person. And we have, you know, sayings in English, my better half and things like this. So that's my understanding of the subject.
Any other questions?